The innovative visionary Juan Trippe, who led Pan Am, believed in possibilities which others simply could not imagine. Over the objections of the rest of the industry, Pan Am launched a tourist class of air travel offering low fares to ordinary people. Trippe could see that air travel could be a democratic conveyance, an affordable form of transport, that could build friendship between peoples because it truly made the world smaller. As the 1970s began, air travel remained reserved for the wealthy few. But Trippe's vision was about to come true, after Pan Am convinced Boeing to build the legendary 747, and with it, average people were able to fly.
Chances are you've heard about the plane with the spiral staircase in first class. The plane with the two wide aisles and the three widescreen movies and the 8-foot ceilings and economy. And chances are you've wondered, who's going to get this incredible bird off the ground? Now you know. Pan Am will bring you the world's first 747. Pan Am will bring you the plane with all the room in the world before you know it.
The phone off the hook. Teach the cat how to cook.
Be a man, not a mouse. Sell your car, rent your house.
Get away, right away, like today. For once in a lifetime, get into this world.
Let the golf take its course. Let the car get a horse.
Leave the house up a tree, lock the door, lose the key.
Get away, right away, like today. For once in a lifetime, get into this world.
Pan Am.
That was Clipper Flight 1 on the 22nd of January 1970, returning back to New York from London after performing the world's first 747 service. As a groundbreaking marvel of engineering, the 747 halved the cost of flying. Suddenly, most people on an average salary could fly.
The Boeing 747 Super Jetliner is making its maiden commercial voyage across the Atlantic from New York to London this evening. It carries more than four times the number of people who manned the Nina, the Pinta, and the Santa Maria back when transatlantic travel all started. And it aims at faster, less expensive air travel than the best we know. The 747, an aerial ocean liner, 80 yards long, 355 tons, seating 362 passengers, more than twice as many as the biggest jet now in service. And the passengers will have more room than ever. Wider seats, living room high ceilings, even on some planes, a cocktail lounge. Flying for the 747 passenger is all comfort. But what will he find on the ground? We ask correspondents around the world whether the airports are ready to cope with the 747.
Paris, at least, is ready. The French may lag in some things, but Orly Airport is ready to load and unload not one, but God forbid, four Boeing 747 jumbo jets at the same time. There are 12 telescopic gangplanks like this one, three to a plane.
This is Satellite West. Satellite East on the other side of the airport will be ready in the spring. Between them, they will be able to handle 4 million extra passengers a year. From this waiting room, empty but ready, the transatlantic passengers will ride what the French call a rolling carpet, what we call a moving sidewalk, 300 feet to the main terminal building. Here is where the bottleneck, if any, will develop. Orly now handles some 21,000 international flight passengers a day, and they all must pick up their luggage on six of these moving belts. At present, these facilities will have to do for the jumbo jet passengers as well. Once you find your bags, you have a choice. If you have something to declare, you will follow the red line and have your bags opened. If you have nothing to declare or claim you have nothing, you take the green line and usually breeze through. But if you're caught on a spot check, you spend hours explaining and pay double duty. It's called customs roulette, and jumbo jet or no, you play at your own risk. Peter Kalischer, CBS News, Paris.
Rome is getting ready too slowly and too late. The bulldozers and excavators are finally at work, digging out a second level that will double the terminal's effective size and become its new arrival area. Airline people say that this work should have begun at least 4 years ago. The airport was opened in 1961. Within a year, it was saturated. Today, it is obsolete. With the first of the 747s due to land here next March, the rosiest estimate is that the new arrival area will be ready only in 18 months. Even without the 747, this is a postage stamp airport, overwhelmed by the onslaught of traffic. It has only two runways. Other inconveniences, the fretful pile-up of passengers at the ticket counters, the harassed queues of tired voyagers at the police booths, the nightmare of a frantic and tiny customs area. For at least a year, the 747's huge baggage containers will disgorge their contents into an area still under construction. There will be no conveyor belts because building machinery will have priority. Airline officials struggle bravely to conceal their despair. They foresee at least one full year of chaos. Winston Burdett, CBS News, Rome.
The 747 has already been here for sightseers to walk through. When it returns carrying passengers, San Francisco Airport will just be starting the reconstruction to get ready for it. The only work underway is on access roads and parking. The city wants to rebuild all the piers and rotundas. We'll start that work in the spring. It will take 3 to 4 years. In the meantime, the airlines plan make do with new waiting rooms. This is the only change the passenger will be able to see. It is expensive remodeling, but far more money is going for big new hangars and taxiways elsewhere at the airport. The 747 is designed for luggage handling in bulk containers, a system which is supposed to be faster. But only one airline will have any containers ready by the time regular service begins. San Francisco Airport won't be ready, but both city and airline officials figure it doesn't have to be. They don't expect the 747 to carry anything near its vast capacity for several years. What will be expensive years for the airlines, waiting for enough customers to fill rows and rows of seats. Jed Duval, CBS News, San Francisco.
These lucky people are headed for Bermuda by bus. For some flights here nowadays, that's the only way to get from the nice, warm, dry terminal through the rain to your airplane. Preparations for the arrival of the 747 at Kennedy International Airport are creating further confusion for already overstrained facilities. Special new gates stand empty while passengers go from plane to bus to terminal in the rain. Pan American Airlines will be the first to put the 747 into service at Kennedy, and Randolph Kirk, the vice president in charge of coordinating ground operations, thinks the airline will eventually have one of the largest, most modern air terminals in the world.
The terminal will expand our total capacity by almost fourfold. Now, you can see that automobiles are driving in at the concourse level here and can stop immediately adjacent to these check-in islands serving the various airplanes. Loading bridges will come out from the building to what we refer to as door number two, left and right, and door number one left. The entire building was designed for a flow-through capability of some 3,000 passengers an hour, including a provision for their well-wishers and greeters.
But for the time being, that glorious new terminal is just a big hole in the ground. No construction could start until runway changes were approved, a long, drawn-out bureaucratic process. The building will not be in full operation until well into 1972. In the meantime, those 747s will bring luxury in the sky, but on the ground, not much more than extra crowding, extra congestion, and those romantic bus rides in the rain.
The message of the 747 to the world is, here comes the next generation of air transport, ready or not. The only trouble is that there are a lot of airports around the globe that are not ready. David Culhane, CBS News, New York.
Jeff Bennett was one of Pan Am's most experienced pilots. He gave this interview aboard a Boeing 707 flight from New York to West Berlin, where he talked about flying as one of the candy bombers.
I knew Berlin when I was a young captain. My first visit was in 1949. We flew vital supplies because the land routes were blocked. For some reason, I always seemed to fly the potatoes. We also flew out refugees, people escaping, including children, which is a memory that always stays with you. One of the children gave me this bear. That's where my bear is from, and ever since that day, my bear is always in my cockpit and in my suitcase or somewhere nearby when I fly.
The sights and sounds of a Pan Am 707 landing in West Berlin, a city virtually under land siege, even by 1970, was a morale boost for the city's residents. More than just a flight, it showed the Western world's dedication to help to keep them free. Along with other cities, Berlin was getting ready for Pan Am's mass travel revolution. Before long, the sleepy Tegel Airport, which was only used for a small number of flights which needed a long runway, would gain a spectacular new terminal. The famous hexagon design meant the walk from taxi cab to plane was less than 1 minute. Although today Tegel has closed down, the hexagon terminal became an icon for Berlin.
At Tempelhof, Pan Am's airline within an airline, internal German services, flew dedicated Boeing 727-100 planes to cities in West Germany. Employing hundreds of local staff, IGS reliably flew West Berliners over the wall, helping to keep West Berlin free.
Leave the phone off the hook. Teach the cat how to cook.
Be a man, not a mouse. Sell your car, rent your house. Get away, right away, like today. For once in a lifetime, get into this world. Let the golf take its course. Let the car get a horse.
Leave the house up a tree. Lock the door, lose the key. Get away, right away, like today. For once in a lifetime, get into this world.
Pan Am makes the going great. Pan Am makes the going great.
Leave the mail in a box, tie the hands of the clocks, hang your tears out to dry, leave your house on the fly, get away right away, like today, for once in a lifetime, get into this world. Let the smoke blow its stack, leave the smog and the flack. Turn the rain into shine. Head for cloud number 9. Get away right away, like today. For once in a lifetime, get into this world. Pan Am makes the going great. Pan Am makes the going great. Pan Am.
During the Cold War era, the West Berlin Air Corridors and Control Zone were three regulated airways for civil and military air traffic of the Western Allies between West Berlin and West Germany, passing over East Germany's territory. America, Britain, and France supplied Air Force officers to act as air traffic controllers, overseeing all aircraft flying in and out of West Berlin. For civilians, these were the only reliable ways in and out of West Berlin. By America's bicentenary in 1976, Pan Am's aim to create mass air travel had become a daily reality. We now board Clipper 101 from London to New York. Enjoy the flight.
Clipper 101, Roger, you're clear to start. Your clearance is a Brecon 28 to Kennedy, squawk 5762.
Clipper 101, Brecon 28.
This is just one of over 370 passenger planes that cross the Atlantic on a busy day.
Fifty percent. Valves closed.
Clipper 101, taxi, please.
Clipper 101, turn left on the outer taxiway for 28 left. Give way to the Speedbird 747. Be coming onto the inner taxiway.
44 airlines now fly the Atlantic. The 400 passengers on board this jumbo think nothing of the 3,500-mile journey ahead of them. The worst thing likely to happen, apart from delay due to the overcrowded skies, is that they've seen the movie before.
Canadian military, 3829. Cut across, trade left now, right turn on the outer.
3829 is
fully turned up at 3. It's a great pleasure having you with us today. We hope you enjoy your flight with us.
At present time, we're at 31,000 feet. Our position is over Strumblehead on the Welsh coast.
And very shortly, we'll be crossing St. George's Channel, overhead Cork in the southern portion of Ireland.
And from which point, we will commence our ocean crossing at the 50th parallel.
Back in the 1920s, no one had yet flown non-stop between New York and Paris. But a new prize stimulated several attempts at this more ambitious journey. Most passengers on today's transatlantic giants, placidly awaiting their meal, are quite unaware that beneath them on the same plane are up to 22 tons of cargo, including mail. And it was mail that was the bread and butter of the airlines in the past. Now, 83,000 people are fed over the Atlantic in one day. But before the plane makers or the airlines were able to operate on anything like this scale, they still had a long way to go. And at first, the result was some enormous white elephants.
01 Kennedy now, 123.7.
23.7, good day, Clipper 101, thank you.
Ciao.
Shortly, Flight 101 will be landing at New York.
Kennedy approach Clipper 101 at 10,000 for 8,000, 250 knots.
Clipper 101, turn left heading 250, descend and maintain 4,000, 8 is Juliet is current.
We have Juliet down to 4,000 and left to 250, Clipper 101.
Clipper 101, squawk 5524.
5524.
That was a journey from London to the great metropolis of New York City. Now we head to the capital of Australia's most populous state, the lively and forward-looking city of Sydney.
Interviewed the youngest and oldest passengers aboard.
My name is Sharon Walter, and I'm 11 years old, and the reason I came on the flight is because my mom and dad are pilots, and, you know, I've sort of worked myself into flying, and I like it. And I like Pan Am.
My name is John Janice. I am 82 years old, and came on this trip because I'm interested in all new developments and new kinds of trips, because I travel as much as 30 to 40,000 miles per year.
Would you do it again?
Yes, I believe I would. I think really I would, because I also enjoyed the company. There were lots of very interesting people on the ship here.
The short-body Boeing 747 SV, for special performance, was designed for ultra-long-range flying. The idea for the SV came after a request by Pan Am to Boeing for a 747 variant capable of flying nonstop between New York and Tehran, plus between California to Hong Kong and Sydney. Pan Am started the 1970s with a dream, the dream of mass air travel, where anyone with an average salary could afford to fly. By the end of the 70s, that dream was a reality.
The goal has always been to take people where they want to go, comfortably and safely. At fares people can afford to pay. With schedules that make it possible for the average person with a two-week vacation to go anywhere in the world. As Pan Am led the way to the Caribbean and into Central and South America, across the Pacific to Asia and Australia, over the Atlantic to Europe and Africa, around the world and finally into the jet age, it was doing more than opening up hundreds of new routes. It was opening millions of minds to the idea of going places far from home. This year, Pan Am will carry over 8 million passengers to 92 cities on 6 continents, making what was once restricted to the wealthy few available to everyone. That is what the Pan Am story is really all about. And the best chapters are yet to come.